Well, hello everybody, and welcome to YouTube lecture number 3. We're going to be dealing with the Great Awakening, hence the opening song there by the great Leonard Cohen. Hallelujah. And if you don't really know what I'm talking about, well, you should do some research, young people. Do your research. So we're going to be looking at the key concepts that deal with this time period, and we're going to obviously be talking a lot about the Great Awakening and filling it in using the key concepts. So if you have them at home, go ahead and take them out at this time. I'll pause for a second and wait for you to go get them. I guess by now you're probably back. If you pause, I wouldn't even know that, would I? All right, so this is Key Concept 2.2. Now, we've been talking a lot about this in way of both political and economic and even social, but cultural exchanges are also taking place between the colonies and Great Britain that are bringing them closer together in some respects. In Roman numeral 1, it tells us this transatlantic commercial world that they're building that's also based on religion and philosophy. It's evolving. It's changing in the colonies. It's going to become something different by the 1700s as to what we had been talking about in class in the 1600s. And you see here, right here in letter A, what I have underlined, especially this enhanced by the first great awakening that's going to happen around the 1730s. You know, you could argue that maybe a little bit was happening in the 1720s, but basically it spearheads in the 1730s. But also, the European Enlightenment is very, very important as to why this massive religious movement is going to take place in America. Also very important, the Anglican Church has this gradual renew birth, as it were. That's where I can't think of the actual word I'm trying to say. I'm stumbling, so I'm going to go with this new birth in America. This growth happens, and it happens because of Puritanism falling apart. The Calvin way of teaching is falling apart in America, and it opens the door for a new Anglican movement that is also going to help spearhead this Great Awakening. And it's also, we'll talk about this as well, it's going to see an emergence of a transatlantic print culture. Newspapers, magazines will explode. A famous book at the time period is going to be called Poor Richard's Almanac. An almanac that becomes very famous by none other than Benjamin Franklin. All right, well, let's get into this. Now, a lot of what I'm going to talk about doesn't really come necessarily from our textbook. It comes from Alan Taylor's American Colonies. So I want to make sure you give credit where credit is due. Pages 339 and 344, and I'm sure you're all going to run out and go buy that book. I think you might remember the name Alan Taylor if you were in class. Looking at the documents, we had a quote from Alan Taylor on the Columbian Exchange. Well, here is some thoughts about what the Great Awakening was. Evangelical revivalism. Evangelicals, born-agains, people who are going to use a lot of emotions to try to get people back into the church, try to revive that Christian spirit, as it were. Not really the Puritan work ethic, but more of a emotional feeling. The Holy Spirit is going to play a prominent role in this. It's going to undermine the traditional values, right? That old Puritan Calvinism way of looking at religion, a very strict way, this idea of conversion, that God has already preordained you to go to heaven or preordained you to go to hell. That is going to start to go away because of the Great Awakening. It's going to promote three main things in America. Pluralism is going to be very, very important. The idea of plural, more than one. So it's not just the Anglican Church or just the Puritan Church. We're going to have Baptists and Methodists and Quakers. You're going to have Anabaptists. You're going to start to accept all forms of Christianity. This idea that all roads will get you to heaven, sort of an idea that we'll be accepting of all religious thought. And no longer the idea that in the Massachusetts, New England colonies, you have to be a member of the Puritan congregation in order to be voting members. Now we'll open up to all the religions. Egalitarianism, the idea of equality, and I'll show you that later too, is how that becomes very important and in many respects lays the groundwork for the American Revolution. Now, there are historians debate this a lot. Some people think the Great Awakening has nothing to do with the American Revolution. I tend to think it has something to do with it. It does bring out this equality ideas. It does get more people involved in a cause, as it were. And as Alan Taylor points out, volunteerism. People begin to volunteer, begin to become more of the community than ever before. Itinerant preachers are going to be a key factor to this. Itinerant, meaning they're traveling preachers. The idea of just staying in a church and having people come to you, well, now we'll have preachers who are on the move. George Whitefield will be a very famous preacher, we'll talk about him here in a little bit, who is a traveling preacher, who'll bring the word to the people. A lot of this will be in the fields, what we call open-air revivals. They want to have hundreds, if not thousands, of people to come hear a preacher, so you can't fit them in a church. So they find an open field where people can come and congregate together, and a preacher will entertain and bedazzle the people with emotional speeches and emotional sermons, and also a lot of scare tactics to try to get you back in the church as well. One of the causes, you can see what is happening to Puritanism in America. If you remember, in 1662, they came up with the halfway covenant. Right, this idea that, you know, the children and the grandchildren of the original Puritan colonists of Massachusetts and the New England colonies weren't understanding conversion anymore, and thereby weren't becoming church members and couldn't vote. So this concept of, well, those of you who are members and your children aren't, if we can get your children baptized, they can be halfway members of the church and then perhaps eventually understand conversion. Well, this won't work. This is not going to help the Calvin faith at all in America. And eventually, over the next 60 years, baptism, the Holy Spirit, those are things that are going to become predominant in Christian teaching, not the idea of conversion and predestination. And again, as I said, Anglican establishments. By 1700, the Anglican church begins to emerge as a very powerful church. Woo! Look at that timing. I don't know if you heard that, but that was thunder in the background. The Anglican Church, woo! So they sought favor with England, the colonies, especially Virginia and Maryland. New York becomes very Anglican at this time period. We mentioned the Enlightenment in our key concepts. Christians will be affected two different ways. You're going to get what we call Christian rationalists, those more conservative Christians who are going to accept more of science and philosophy and reason, and not really play up the miracles of the Bible or play up emotional thoughts, versus the more emotional revivalist. They are also readers of the Enlightenment, but they believe that emotion is very important. That's what's going to get people in the church. We'll talk about them a little bit more later as well. Here we are, revivalism in America. The Great Awakening is upon us. Again, evangelicals, the idea of being born again. Yes, that you are having what they born-agains call a new birth. And it's shown through two things, baptism and the Holy Spirit, not conversion. They believe that if you feel the Holy Spirit, okay, I think we got the point on that, but so you feel the Holy Spirit, it can move you. It can dwell in you. You can find it within yourself to come to God. This idea of conversion, right? Calvin's believe that you were born with it. It was predestined. So that's what the Puritans taught. Now they're teaching, well, we believe in conversion, but now you can earn it, right? You can search out God. You can listen to these soul-searching sermons, these scare tactics, bringing you closer to God, either by bringing the thought that you might go to hell if you do not do this, or you can just find the Spirit within you. One of the great preachers of the time period is Jonathan Edwards. Jonathan Edwards wrote quite a few things in this time period, but the most famous sermon he will write that is still among us to this day is sinners in the hands of an angry God. 1741. And here's Jonathan Edwards preaching to his congregation. And here, I'll just read you one of the most famous quotes in this sermon. And see if this would get you back in church. He says, "The God that holds you over the pit of hell, much as one holds a spider or some loathsome insect over the fire, abhors you and is dreadfully provoked. His wrath towards you burns like fire. He looks upon you as worthy of nothing else but to be cast into the fire. He is a purer eyes than to bear to have you in his sight. You are 10,000 times so abnormal in his eyes as the most hateful and venomous serpent is in ours." Yeah, I don't know. That might get me running in the other direction. But this was emotionalism, right? This was spurring up within you Holy Spirit, scaring you that if you don't accept Holy Spirit, if you don't get baptized, like we might step on an insect, God is going to cast you into hell. We also call these people, these revivalists, new lighters, as opposed to the old lighters, those anti-revivalists, those who wanted to hold on to the old Calvinistic teaching, those who still believed only in conversion was part of predestination. They became the old lighters. These are the established ministers who don't want to give up their Puritan thinking, and they do not like these new lighters. New lighters fell into two categories. There were more moderate evangelicals. Yes, we believe in Holy Spirit. We believe in baptism. But we don't believe in excesses. You know, we're not going to go totally crazy with this. We are really going to focus on the Bible and the Bible teachings. We're going to use emotionalism to help get people into the church, but we will use Scripture to do this. As opposed to the radicals, who sometimes we call Holy Spirit extremists. And we'll talk about a couple of them later on, or one particular guy later on, who will do anything he can to get people into the church. The old lighters feared both of these people. They felt like this was a break from Puritan tradition. This was not God's plan. And so they feared both of them. They feared the radicals more because they went to real extremes. Notice here, though, in this painting of Edwards, perhaps giving his sermon, "Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God." And notice the congregation in this painting. Sitting right up front is a woman, but also in the background is a man of color. This is what makes this an egalitarian movement, a movement of equality. The Great Awakening is going to open up the church to women, to Native American Indians, and to African slaves. Thousands will be converted to Christianity during this movement because they no longer have to worry about conversion. Now they all have to think about is baptism. Get baptized in the church. Feel the Holy Spirit. In fact, at this time period, this again is what some of the old lights begin to fear. Moderates begin to allow women to preach in church. Oh, no. Yes, this starts to happen. Certain Native American Indians become ministers and become itinerant preachers and travel throughout the New England colonies preaching, and thousands of white people will come hear them because they believe Holy Spirit is motivating them now. Even African slaves will get the Spirit. There are those even in the South that will allow their slaves to travel as itinerant preachers, even though they're slaves. But again, the Holy Spirit is moving us. So an equal movement, and what we call an egalitarian movement of equality, is starting to happen because of the Great Awakening. And in that sense, that's what's really important about the Great Awakening. It did allow for more women to get involved in social issues and cultural issues. It allowed Native Americans and African Americans to get involved through religion, but they got involved in social causes. This really is what old lighters began to fear. They did not like any of this, especially seeing women preach in churches. Another very famous individual of the time is George Whitefield. George Whitefield, He started off his career as a thespian. He was an actor who eventually found the spirit within him. He is from England. He is an Anglican itinerant preacher. Right? So the Anglican Church is becoming more and more involved now in this type of Holy Spirit teachings and baptism. Because he was an actor, and he would put on plays, and he would reenact, right? For instance, the Passion of the Christ. He would have thousands of followers throughout England. And there's a funny thing I always think about it. He could bring people to their knees. He could have them fall to their knees, crying and screaming for the Holy Spirit when he would give his lecture of the history of man. And he would start off by saying one word, "Well, man lived in Mesopotamia." I think you've heard of Mesopotamia, but apparently that one word sometimes could just bring people just overflowing, men crying, women fainting, and everyone just, oh, hallelujah. He said the word Mesopotamia. Well, one of the things he's famous for is he built a lot of orphanages in England. And he decided he was going to bring his message to America, and he's going to try and build an orphanage in Georgia, the colony of Georgia. But he's going to travel the New England and the middle colonies trying to raise funds to build this. And he finds an ally in Benjamin Franklin. Yes, look at this. One of our founding fathers we finally get to mention, and it's because of the Great Awakening. We're going to talk a lot about Benjamin Franklin later on. He originally is from Boston, but as a young boy, he'll run away to Pennsylvania. We'll talk about that later on. He is one of the leading newspaper men in all the world, perhaps. He has a famous book called Poor Richard's Almanac. And a print revolution has taken place in America. More and more Americans are learning to read. And they want to read newspapers. And they want to read magazines because they want to know what's going on in the world. Believe it or not, there was a time period where even teenagers wanted to know what was going on in the world. I know. Isn't that cray-cray? And they didn't even have Twitter in that time period. They really wanted to read full-on newspapers. With George Whitefield coming over, and he comes to Philadelphia. By the way, Benjamin Franklin, we should point out, not really a believer. Okay, he believes in what we call deism. There is a God, but he's not all into all the Christian scriptures. He's not really into making, you know, anything about Jesus. But he really likes Whitefield. He gets very into the emotional and the theatrics of Whitefield. And he sees an opportunity to take his sermons and reprint them in his newspapers. I think he's thinking of something else there. Maybe a little bit more financial gain than anything else. But Benjamin Franklin really did like George Whitefield, and he really saw an honest person within him. And he's going to make a little coin out of this as well. So this helps to escalate the print revolution in America. And it's not just Franklin, but newspapers in Boston and New York, newspapers in Savannah, Georgia, newspapers emerge in Charleston, North Carolina, in Virginia, and Williamsburg. More and more newspapers are emerging in America. And the Great Awakening is a huge catalyst for this. More Americans want to read, right? So this is another great thing about the Great Awakening. It actually helps to elevate the education level of America. As I said, the Holy Spirit teachings led to more democratic, egalitarian principles of equality. It levels the social field, as I showed you in that other painting. Men, women, white, black, Indian, it did not matter. It was open to all people, and all people were getting involved. Now, I'm not going to tell you that it's like 100% of the population. No, it's probably a much, much less than that. But it still was a huge catalyst for changing landscape within America. Religion has now changed. We're now accepting all Christian faiths. The old Puritan thought of conversion and predestination is going away. More people are getting involved. The Holy Spirit and baptism. But as I tell you, there's also those extremists. Enter James Davenport. One of the things about the Holy Spirit is that it allows for people not to go to any type of college in order to become a minister. You can claim the Holy Spirit moves you. And that's what happens to James Davenport. And he, well, let's just say a little on the cuckoo side. At least twice, maybe three different times, he will actually be arrested by old lighters because of the style that he teaches. And March 7th, 1743, some people mark as the end of the Great Awakening because he's in Boston and he holds this massive bonfire and he has so many followers. You know, it's a mob comes out and the mob mentality takes over, you know, and people are all just screaming, Davenport, Davenport, we love Davenport. And he starts preaching about the excesses of society. Materialism is against God. And he starts throwing clothes on the fire. And at one point, he even takes off his own pants. And he's like, we have to get rid of our clothes. Our clothes are separating us from the Lord. And there are people who are thinking, take off their shirts and jackets. And women thinking, we'll take off our bonnets and maybe our outer skirts and throw them on the fire. And it's this really crazy moment. And at one point, an elderly lady will slap him, bringing him back to his senses, and then people kind of, this is kind of ridiculous. He'll be arrested again for this, and people start thinking, well, maybe we're going way too far to extremes. Gilbert Tennent is an Irish minister who wrote The Dangers of an Unconverted Ministry. And one of the things he winds up doing is he starts to call those old lighters dead dogs. That also begins to enrage people that you're going a little too far here. There's also the case of a woman who would show up at these revivals in a wheelchair, and then all of a sudden the Holy Spirit would strike her and she could walk again, right? And people would get amazed and they would give all kinds of donations because of this, and then she would disappear only to show up at a different revival in another county in the wheelchair again, and to miraculously walk all over again. So you can see where some of these extremists start to take advantage of the people. And this is some of the things that really feared, the old lighters feared. But the Great Awakening will change religion. No one, the idea of conversion is going to go away. Well, I won't say permanently, that's actually wrong. But the majority of Americans now are going to look only towards baptism and the leanings and the feelings of the Holy Spirit. But more importantly than anything else, it led to this idea of equality in America. It led to pluralism, multiple religions, and the volunteer spirit is the three big things that we get out of this. We also get a higher educated population because people begin to read these things. More and more newspapers and magazines and books are going to be written about this. So that also is a huge importance. And in a lot of respects, it does get people on that road to eventual thinking about independence. I'm not going to say it's a direct cause of the American Revolution, but it's definitely one of those back burner type causes. All right, I hope I entertained you a little bit. This probably went a little long, and I'm sorry for that. But here's some things to focus on in our textbook. And again, that's a lot of pages, but I only want you to focus on these things here. The Enlightenment, what is deism, right? What is this belief? And again, make sure you're familiar with Jonathan Edwards and this new religion that emerges in America we call the Baptist. All right, until next time, have a good night.